Please welcome Persistent Universe Game Director, Tony Zurovec.
I had to give some real thought about what it was that I wanted to discuss while I was out here. In the end, rather than going into a lot of intricate detail about one particular feature and running the risk that a lot of you guys here might not find that one topic very interesting, I decided to go broad and touch on a number of different things while at the same time going deep enough that hopefully you guys will hear some things that you haven't yet, you know, heard before. The hope is that you'll come away with a more comprehensive understanding of what we view as the next tier of priorities for Star Citizen's Persistent Universe. Oh, yeah. So as many of you have previously heard, our long-term objective is for a fully systemic world. And what this means is that we want a dynamic, logical environment with a completely consistent set of rules that can intelligently adapt to whatever players throw at it to ensure that the level of challenge is always going to be appropriate. This is really important for a number of reasons, and one of the biggest ones is that we want to give players total freedom. So this causes a lot of problems for a game designer, though, because it means that we can't really assume anything. And at times, certain elements of the game can become extremely unbalanced. So for example, every player might simultaneously decide that they want to live the life of a pirate and start attacking cargo freighters that are ferrying platinum from a refinery to a production facility. So if everything were to remain static, if the game couldn't appropriately compensate, it wouldn't feel like our real world, and it definitely wouldn't feel very fun. What you'd really expect instead would be a lot of changes as players started to go that route. Those cargo freighters should demand higher fees to travel into such a dangerous area. The price for an armed escort should go through the roof, which should, of course, entice a lot more players and NPCs into going out and actually serving as security. So miners should react to these elevated prices, of course, by trying to find and produce more platinum. And in the end, this is really just basic supply and demand economics. And the effects that it generates serve as counterweights to the pressure that the players exert. They're essentially attempts by the system to compensate for these imbalances that occasionally take hold. And so this algorithmic content, of course, can sometimes feel a bit formulaic if you take it too far, when that's all there is to a game. And that's why we're layering on a lot of custom handcrafted content onto that systemic backdrop, unique characters, specific challenges, and a lot of very intricately detailed areas that artists are spending many, many months, you know, crafting. So setting up an algorithmic system like this means that we need to be able to objectively evaluate an item's value. And this has been a real problem for us in the past because the original ship and item prices were pretty arbitrary. They were really just best guesses that, you know, were made at the time. Starting with 3.3, however, we've moved to a model that allows us to much more precisely define what's required to produce an item, including everything from the type and quantity of materials, the amount of labor that's going to be involved, the production technology, the factory capacity, the amount of time that will be required. And these pricing changes are going to ripple through the entire production pipeline. And this is crucially important to us, because the price of one item, basically this is a really important step forward because it gives us clarity with regards to how dozens of other variables within the system need to react, and thus it enables some of the much more complicated equations that we need to enact to accomplish this, you know, to be realized. Here we have a chart that I had Jake Mealy, one of our Austin designers, create right in the last few days before this. And what it essentially illustrates is a price breakdown of the freelancer ship. And this is a work in progress, and the values will inevitably evolve, but it should give you a pretty good sense of how we're measuring and evaluating these things. So looking at this, you can see, for example, that the relative percentage of the freelancer's price that's caused by the shield generator in blue towards the bottom, that's not arbitrary. The size and strength of that shield generator were determined by the same equations that would be used to calculate shield generators used in other ships. And it's that consistency, that objectivity, that's really important to us. And what this means is that if something like the price of a commodity used in the production of that shield generator, or maybe what a unit of labor costs at the factory where they're produced, if that changes, we'll be able to precisely calculate what that means for the price of both shield generators, freelancers, and anything else that uses, you know, those elements within its production. And this is basically just another view of that same pricing model showing off a half dozen ships being compared. The proposed price you can see at the far left, and you'll start to see some of these rippling into the game here relatively soon. This more objective way of looking at ships and items is also really beneficial when we're trying to ascertain what kind of capabilities we want to bestow upon a new item, because it allows us to easily visualize where there may be gaps in the offerings that would make a lot of sense to fill. And there are some additional benefits to this systemic approach. At the top of the list, I would say, is the fact that it's intuitive. You basically just tend to expect that if there's a shortage in something, that prices are going to rise, and that if there's a surplus, that prices are going to fall. You won't typically have enough information at your disposal to know exactly how a change in one, you know, how a change in price in one thing or another will ripple through the economy. But at a macro level, you should be able to intelligently infer quite a bit. And this actually leads to another major positive, which is that systemic systems tend to reward very clever gameplay. Basically, behavioral changes tend to, without trying to go too deep into this, behavioral changes tend to often lag behind an economy, which in turn leads to boom and bust cycles. And this happens in the real world all the time. If you think about copper, for instance, if worldwide demand for copper were to jump dramatically tomorrow, then mining companies would add an extra shift in order to be able to compensate, to allow them to ramp up production. And if demand were to still outstrip supply, then they might think about bringing on more workers, but that could take months before they actually get these guys hired up and trained. And if a demand was exceptionally robust, they might even consider searching for new mines, constructing new refineries, and things of that sort. But at that point, you're really talking about many years before that additional production capacity would actually come online. And the reverse, of course, is true as well. Overcapacity tends to lead to prolonged down cycles in prices. And these natural swings in prices, they can make life very difficult for the unprepared, but clever players are going to see tons of opportunity. So if you're a miner focused on copper and the price tanks, you've got lots of different options. You could always, of course, change to a different occupation, take up, you know, bounty hunting or, you know, something completely different. You might cut back on what you're willing to pay combat escorts or eliminate them entirely on the presumption that since the ore you'd be carrying is fetching less, pirates would likely be less attracted and less drawn to you. Or you might try to focus on increasing your efficiency by turning your attention to higher quality mines so that you could basically attain more value, realize more value with fewer trips, which basically means less fuel, less time, less crew costs if you actually have that, et cetera, et cetera. Another option, one of my favorites, would actually be speculation. You could always continue to extract whatever material you're focused upon, but rather than actually selling it into the open market, you might just go and rent additional cargo storage space and store it. There's a cost and there's a risk to that, though, in that that storage space doesn't come free. And so you're basically making an investment on the presumption that prices are going to bounce back within some sort of, you know, reasonable period of time. But in the end, these are all just, you know, alternative ways by which, you know, different players will choose to deal with, you know, the inevitable modulation of prices that you get, you know, with economies that tend to behave fairly realistically. Now, on occasion, I'll make reference to a variety of different types of NPCs, four specific, you know, types in particular, and so I thought that it might make a little bit of sense for now and in the future to basically give you guys a little bit of background on what I'm talking about when I refer to these. Simulated NPCs are really at the heart of the background economy. They're extremely simple entities that are endowed with just very basic personality traits that help to dictate their behavior. They're never going to be directly seen, and their purpose is to allow the economy to intelligently flow and react to the different imbalances that it's, you know, that it's going to see. They'll directly fuel things like factory labor and help to determine what missions are available where and for what price. They'll also dictate the actual number of NPCs that you'll see at a given landing zone and their occupations. Their actions are also going to provide inputs to the so-called probability volumes that you're so that what you see in a given area is truly representative of what you should be seeing if you could actually, you know, delve down into this little virtualized world. Probabilistic NPCs are much closer to the actual, game. They're handled on the back end, and basically the NPCs that they represent, they're not technically NPCs at all. They really are just probabilities. This functionality has actually been in the game since 3.0, but as of right now, designers still dictate their contents by hand. And as noted above, this is actually going to change when simulated NPCs start to come online. And this entire concept is basically a large optimization that allows us to track key elements at the level of detail needed without impacting anything that any player could actually ever see. Virtual NPCs, which I'll sometimes refer to as spoofed, these are actually going to come online next year, and they're particularly interesting for a number of different reasons. I'm going to go into more detail about these a little bit later in the presentation, and so we'll come back to that. The last type of NPC, of course, are real NPCs that you actually see within the game. These are the non-player characters that, you know, for all practical purposes, could just as easily be another player. They're fully simulated, they're quite expensive, and it's for this reason that all of these other types of NPCs actually exist. It would be exorbitantly expensive, computationally expensive, which ultimately to you guys means that you'd see, you know, frame rates take a hit. We'd have, you know, much higher server costs if we were actually trying to do this, if we were actually trying to simulate everything in completely realistic fashion. And again, as I'll get to in a little bit, there are actually some negatives that even if we were going about doing things to that level of detail and really were willing to, you know, try to, you know, fully emulate, you know, every single entity, there are actually some significant negatives to that. So another thing that I wanted to touch on is the dynamic mission system. And this is actually one of the more important pieces of gameplay tech that's going to debut next year. But before I get into that, it would make sense to talk a bit about where we currently stand and some of the limitations that we currently face. So right now, all of the mission content that we have within the game is completely static. There's no way for the designers to control how many of a given mission is available at a given location or the price or anything of that sort. There's also no way for them to automatically customize those missions based upon the current state of the economy. Now, the designers have, you know, valiantly attempted to circumvent some of these limitations as best they could, but the reality is that they've just been missing a critical piece of the puzzle. And so the dynamic mission system is intended to change all of that, to provide a direct link to the economy so that things can be algorithmically customized as appropriate without requiring any sort of special effort on the part of the designer. And before I get too far into this system, though, I wanted to find one more term that's going to occasionally pop up and that you have probably heard quite a few times just in various, you know, chats on the website. Environmental mission scenarios are created via subsumption, very much like normal missions. One key difference, though, is that they often don't have explicit objectives that you're intended to accomplish. They're used to basically create the world that should just be going on around you, but which we don't actually construct unless you're there to actually see it. These scenarios are instantiated via probability volumes, which are basically regions of space that define the likelihood of encountering different things. And it's within these volumes that the probabilistic NPCs I mentioned earlier exist, if you really want to call it that. So As a player makes their way through a probability volume, it queries a library of mission content to determine what the player should see, and then it actually creates it. And so for the quantum mechanically inclined amongst you, this is basically like you're flying around the universe, collapsing the wave function wherever you go. That's where the probabilities basically, you know, coalesce into reality, and you can actually see it. That's where we take things, you know, out of, you know, the land of probabilities, which we do because it's so much more efficient, you know, like I was saying earlier. And we, at that point, we actually create real NPCs on a real server, which you can interact with. So a volume might indicate that there's a certain chance of encountering a cargo freighter and a slightly smaller chance of encountering a pirate. So as you fly around that area then, you'll occasionally see a cargo freighter and a bit less frequently a pirate. And I mentioned earlier that there were some significant negatives, even if we were to try to simulate everything at a, you know, at a complete level. So one of the benefits of this approach that we're doing, besides being a really effective optimization, is that it allows us to highlight what I'd call the interesting moments. If you think about how large space is and how infrequently you actually run into things, the odds that you'd ever run into a cargo freighter right as a pirate was closing on them, or just as the pirate had disabled them and had docked to their ship and was just about to be, you know, begin a breaching operation, the odds of you coming upon that at that particular moment would be infinitesimally small. But it's actually those moments that are sometimes, you know, the most interesting from a gameplay's perspective. And so what we get with this system, besides all the optimization, is really just a natural predisposition towards a higher than normal, you know, frequency of that type of thing happening. So getting back on track a little bit, the dynamic mission service serves as an intermediary between the game servers and the universe economy service, periodically querying the simulated universe and then using that information to modify all sorts of things that the players will directly see and experience. And this means that missions will start being offered only at locations where they're actually needed, where there's a legitimate function that the economy has determined needs to be performed, and that the prices offered will be justified by what's currently happening within the world. So the dynamic mission system is also going to allow for a lot more intelligent customization of missions, which in turn is going to equate to a lot more variety. And this won't just be the case for the missions that you explicitly accept. It'll also carry over to environmental mission scenarios. So right now, when a probability volume instantiates one of these environmental mission scenarios, the content is totally fixed. There's no way to customize anything based upon the current situation at that particular moment. With this system, though, we'll be able to start doing things like dictating the type and quantity of cargo, whether a cargo freighter should have escorts, a ship's current level of damage, and all sorts of other things based upon what makes sense in that area. And this is probably kind of an esoteric concept, but to give you a better understanding of why this is a really powerful concept, I'll go into a quick and very simple example. So imagine that there is an asteroid field with a lot of very valuable resources and a distant refinery, and thus there's a lot of back and forth activity. There's basically mining ships that are heading, you know, from the refinery out to the asteroid field, extracting value, and then heading back with, you know, with the full cargo hold. So between those two locations, there are also a lot of pirates. So there are a lot of things that you can or that you should be able to infer about this scenario, all of which the dynamic mission system is going to help automatically resolve. So if you were to fly between the asteroid field and the refinery, you'd of course expect to occasionally encounter a miner, sometimes encounter a pirate, and sometimes both. However, if you ran into a miner heading towards the asteroid field, you'd expect that their cargo hold would actually be empty. They were heading there to go stock up. Similarly, if a miner were heading back towards the refinery, you'd expect that their cargo hold would not only be full, but that it would be loaded up with whatever commodities were present within that asteroid field. And pirates obviously would logically focus on those miners that had something of value, such that you'd expect miners on the way to the asteroid field to typically be in a completely undamaged state. When they were basically heading in that direction, they had nothing of value. And those that were heading back to the refinery that you encountered would sometimes be much worse off, which would effectively reflect the fact that they may have already tangled with some pirates and just managed to get away. And so if you ran into a scenario where a pirate ship had disabled a freighter, docked with it, and it was getting ready to or already breaching, you'd also expect that the freighter must therefore have cargo, be returning from the field, or else the pirate would have logically tangled with a, with a completely different ship. So the dynamic mission system is going to allow us to customize a lot of this content automatically, so that the things you see are completely logical in nature without the designers having to do any special work. So one more big one to hit here, which is mission spoofing. That's another major feature that the dynamic mission system is going to expose. I've spoken a good bit about how a lot of stuff doesn't really become real. It doesn't start getting simulated by the game servers where it's really expensive until there's actually a player around to see it. Prior to that, things are kept in a much more efficient state. But there's one big problem with this approach, and that's the fact that some NPCs, even the ones that aren't near a player, have a legitimate need to exist in something more than just probabilistic form at significant distances from players. And that's because of the service beacon. So the dynamic mission system is going to query the probability volumes to determine the frequency and specifics of service beacon requests. This would equate to NPCs that are asking you for a service. In other words, you may be getting a call from a guy that's far away, and we don't want to, once again, go to all the effort of creating him until it's really necessary. And so what the system will do is effectively spoof those offers. It will create a little virtual NPC. That NPC will be able to fire commands through the normal communication network, and what you'll see will look and feel just like a request from any other player. It's only at the point that the beacon was actually accepted, when a player agreed to provide the service that the NPC was requesting, that the system would actually transform this spoof, this lightweight NPC, into a real NPC with which you could actually interact. And this might seem like a lot of effort, and it is, but it's really necessary, because the reality is that most of the service beacons that are going to get dispatched throughout the system will never be answered by a player. They may effectively be canceled by an NPC that decides to take it. And so what we don't want to have is for every player to have 10 service beacons getting fired off and be creating all of creating all those characters, creating all of those ships, executing all that logic when there's no one around to actually see it. So there's one other thing here that I wanted to talk about, which is the focused NPC generation. And basically, this applies to players, it applies to two different things. The first thing is actually players with a large price on their head are inevitably going to attract bounty hunters, and they're not all going to be players. These NPCs are handled a bit differently because they have actual purpose, and when they finally run into you, it's not going to be a random encounter, and thus they're not particularly good candidates for the normal random probabilistic distribution within a probability volume. So you can think of them a bit as ghost NPCs that quietly track you around the universe, following any breadcrumbs you're leaving, and doing their very best to find you. Once the system has determined that they've succeeded, they'd arrive on the scene, finally get converted into a real NPC, and engage you just as a player might. This focused NPC generation also plays a role in the creation of NPC service providers. And this is, to some degree, the mirror image of what I discussed a moment ago, but this time it involves the creation of an NPC in response to your requesting a service. In such cases, the dynamic mission service will query the probability volumes to determine whether an NPC would respond, and if so, they'd be instantiated and directed towards your location. So this is effectively what would happen when you're requesting combat assistance, or you're requesting passenger transport, or you're asking to be refueled or repaired, and no players take the call. At that point, what the system is going to do is effectively query all of the NPCs that would theoretically exist within that area and determine whether or not any of them would actually be interested, and if so, it's at that moment that they actually become real. So the next thing up is the law and order system. We're going to be making a lot of changes to the Law and Order system over the next year, but before getting into that, it probably makes sense to give a quick recap of where we currently stand. So at the moment, we currently have the concept of a global criminal reputation, which is a bit like a rolling history of your criminal actions. It can't be altered except via time and the actions that you do. We also have a wanted level, and it increases whenever a crime is committed within range of an operational comm array, and it can be removed by hacking a terminal or by getting killed by AI security or a bounty hunter. And lastly, if a bounty hunter takes out such a criminal, you immediately get paid. So there are a number of problems with this system, and we'll get into a little bit of detail. So the new law system is going to revolve around the concept of these hierarchical jurisdictions. And a jurisdiction is basically just an area that defines its own set of laws or which adds or extends the laws of its parents. So you might think of the UEE as the federal government. Crusader might be considered a state, and Port Olisar could be considered a city. The laws of the UEE would certainly be in force within Port Olisar, but Port Olisar might go a bit farther and prohibit the possession of certain substances within its jurisdiction. And each of these jurisdictions are going to maintain their own criminal database, and it will be accessible to all law enforcement, all AI security and bounty hunters that are registered within that jurisdiction. And here's a list of some of the crimes that we've been debating. Theft would, of course, just be taking something that doesn't belong to you. Manslaughter, killing without malice. A good example of that would be a bounty hunter that's in the process. They're in close proximity to a bounty, that they're actually after, and they inadvertently kill someone else. In that case, you can kind of infer that they probably didn't do it intentionally, and thus the penalty should be a lot less than something intentional like murder. But it might involve something like, temporary ejection from the Bounty Hunters Guild, et cetera. And this is, intended to discourage bounty hunters from getting too careless, when they've basically been authorized to go after people, within these secure zones. Next up would be illegal mining, and that would really just equate to extracting resources from a parcel of a planetary body or moon that you don't own, that it belongs to another player, or perhaps it belongs to the government, and it's not been opened up for public mining. Illicit cargo, that would involve transportation or possession of a material that's deemed illegal, maybe an addictive drug or a volatile compound that requires a special license to transport. Smuggling would involve the transportation of intentionally hidden goods that are either stolen or illicit. Murder would, of course, be one of the more obvious ones. It just involves, the outright killing, of a player within a secure zone for no justified reason. False ID would basically equate to you using a kit that allows you to throw off a false signature so that when you're actually scanned by others, you can basically, give them a sense that you might be law-abiding. Quantum interdiction and dampening, those would relate to the illegal creation of a field intended to inhibit quantum travel, which of course is a tactic that's going to be very popular with pirates looking to snare their prey. And each of the laws within these jurisdictions will be able to be associated with a penalty, and this can be anything from as minor as a fine that might elevate to a bounty if you don't pay it on time. It could result in bounties, and there are two different bounties. There's the dead or alive variety, and then there's capture. Capture would typically apply to some of the less serious crimes, smuggling to where you weren't actually causing bodily injury to someone. Prison duration, how much time you're actually going to serve as a result of this banishment, you could be restricted from going into a particular city or zone for some period of time. Now, the law system relies upon security forces being able to ascertain whether an individual has a criminal record, and this will be handled by various forms of scanning. So the quickest and simplest type of scan is for ships, and it's somewhat akin to basically running a license plate. The next up would be the FPS variant, and this requires you to be in close proximity to another character and to have a view of the character's face. Security forces can, of course, do more than just try and identify a known criminal. They can also try to detect crimes that are still in progress. To that end, ships will be able to be scanned for more than just, you know, the license plate. A deeper, more time-consuming scan, one that requires a bit more player skill, can return the quantity and type of cargo on board. And this will also be of value to pirates who want to basically know whether or not a freighter has anything that's, you know, interesting before they actually, you know, move in to engage. Upon verification of the presence of illicit cargo, a bounty would be automatically issued if it didn't already exist, and the security officer would then be cleared to engage as appropriate. And then there would be a still deeper, you know, more time-consuming, more, you know, more skill-requiring scan that would allow you to, you know, effectively detect smuggled cargo. There will be few NPCs and probably few players that are actually going to master that, and thus, in general, smuggling will typically be a relatively safe, a relatively safe occupation, except in the most secure zones. All of these scans are, of course, detectable by the target. With more skillful scanners, less likely to be noticed. As with the current system, security forces are spawned via environmental mission scenarios, and thus encounters with them are purely by chance based upon the density of security in that area. And these forces aren't immediately hostile. It's similar to just running into a cop while you're driving on the streets. So unless you actually get scanned, they don't really know your identity. Once security is verified that you're a known criminal, then everything changes. You get a pursuit rating, and all of a sudden, security is not summoned to that area merely, you know, incidentally as a result of the probability volume. Now it actually directs additional security traffic towards you. And so the way to basically, you know, get them off your tail is to evade them for a significant period of time, at which point your pursuit rating will gradually go down and the density of, you know, of directed NPCs will basically, you know, gradually dissipate. The last thing I wanted to go into on the law and order system is prisons, and they're going to, you know, effectively serve as additional deterrent to committing crimes within lawful areas. And I can't go into too much detail here since we're still working out the details of exactly what type of gameplay you'd experience while confined. And I'm sure we'll start out, you know, fairly modestly and then gradually ramp up the ambition. We definitely want to have some interesting characters and missions within the prisons, which can in turn open up some interesting doors on the outside. Manual labor to reduce your prison sentence, penance for being bad, is also pretty high on our list. Players with a bounty on their head that are captured or killed would be immediately transported to prison, and the duration of their sentence would depend upon the number and severity of offenses. We're also going to wind up introducing some anti-theft devices, because right now it's far too easy to basically steal these, you know, enormously expensive, you know, ships that represent a tremendous store of value. So we'll likely implement things along the lines of a security pad that, you know, would either require a significant amount of time or some hacking skill for you to bypass, or a physical key that resides on your body, which basically means someone can't actually start your ship unless they, at the very least, first take you out and then search your body. We're also going to make it substantially more difficult for you to, you know, fly these stolen ships throughout the system. And by that I mean players with stolen ships are going to become much less able to frequent a bunch of the shops that provide refueling repair services. So they're therefore going to have to head out to the criminal areas, the lawless areas, in order to take care of a lot of those types of basic operations. And of course, the prices out there are going to be more expensive, and there's also just the added hassle of making the journey. So after talking so much about the law and order system, I think it probably only makes sense to give you guys a little bit of a sense as to where we're headed with bounty hunting. One of the first few things you're going to notice once the dynamic mission system starts to come online will be the directed NPC bounty hunters. And I spoke about this a bit earlier in the dynamic mission system section, but these bounty hunters won't be dependent upon a probability volume to spawn them, and their capabilities and frequency are going to increase as the price on your head grows. Many jurisdictions will have a resident bounty hunting guild, and there are a lot of benefits to registration. There are also going to be some costs. Some will require a certain level of reputation in order for you to join. Some will require a recurring membership fee, and others may require you to maintain a certain quota of bounties. One of the largest benefits to registering is that you'll gain access to a MobiGlass bounty hunting application that can show you a wealth of information about that jurisdiction's criminals, including their names, crimes, bounties, total reward being offered, and most importantly, their last known position and ship. And this information is updated in real time so that once you're registered as a bounty hunter, anything that detects the presence of a known felon within that area will be automatically broadcast to you. And this all kind of goes towards, you know, in the direction of making life, you know, more difficult for people that are going out and committing these crimes and then basically trying to wander, you know, around through secure systems. One of the nicer aspects of the new system is basically that it's going to eliminate the need to manually accept individual bounties. Now you're just going to automatically be registered. You're going to automatically have knowledge of any bounties that are known by that jurisdiction. It's also going to improve navigation. There will be no more clumsy going to the star map and trying to basically pick, you know, whatever zone or region is closest to the last known location of your target. One of my favorite features is actually quantum trail tracking, and that's not just a feature for bounty hunters, but they're certainly going to use it a lot. Whenever a player jumps from one location to another, they're going to leave a trail that, with the right equipment, you'll be able to see. And this means that if your bounty or whoever you're chasing manages to jump away, you'll be able to follow them. So the quality of the bounty, the quality of the tracking equipment and the size of the ship is going to dictate how long this trail can be detected. So you'll need to be fairly close on the heels of your prey if you want to have a chance at actually following. Another change that will involve what we're calling virtuals, again, spoofed NPC bounties. And this is similar to the ghost concept that I mentioned before, except in this particular case, the spoofed NPCs are your targets. And so you can think of it as you're registered as a bounty hunter. Of course, you'll be tracking the players, but we're also going to have a lot of NPCs, you know, that we don't want to truly have driving around, flying ships, doing all of this expensive stuff, unless there's a player to see them. And so these, you can think of them as just little point like entities that can move from location to location, occasionally tripping the security alarms so that you can actually follow them. And they'll generate everything just as a player would in terms of they go to a system, then you may wind up, you know, seeing them trip, you know, a facial ID camera at a particular area. And if you get there quickly enough, there would actually be a good chance that they'd be in that location. If it turns out that they're not in that area, then you may see a quantum trail that's been left by this little virtual entity. And so effectively, it's going to allow you to start truly hunting people. Right now, as soon as you kill someone with a bounty on your head, you get paid. This is going to change so that payment is withheld until you've delivered proof of death to the appropriate security office. Capture bounties are going to work similarly, but with one key difference. If an NPC is disabled, they'll simply surrender and follow you, with the idea being that you'd take them to the designated prison, at which point you'd be paid. It's slightly different for a player because it wouldn't be very fun if another player captured you to basically sit on their ship for who knows how long, and there's no guarantee that they'd take you straight to the prison. So if you actually wind up submitting another player, at that moment they're simply teleported to prison. You wind up getting a proxy NPC to fill their place. That proxy NPC will behave just like, you know, a normal NPC that you captured, and you march them back to go collect your money. Bounty hunters won't, of course, be simply confined to space. There will be FPS bounty hunters, both players and NPCs, wandering around the cities. And so every time, you know, if you're actually moving through a city, you've got a price on your head, and people start, you know, coming up to you and basically, you know, focusing on you a little bit too long, it may be a sign that they're actually, you know, running your ID, and they may, you know, they may be authorized to engage you as soon as they get verification. Also wanted to talk a little bit about salvage. Salvage revolves around the extraction of bits of value from a ship. And there are three distinct methods of salvage. The first one is component extraction, and that simply involves the removal of components from the ship. This may require bypassing a security system to gain access to the module, or cutting the items from their fixed housings. These components will often be small enough to be carried, and thus significant value, power generators, shield generators, batteries, and things of that sort, can be gleaned, you know, from these ships with enough trips. Data extraction involves transferring electronic data from the ship to another medium. Some forms of data can only be copied if the original is destroyed, enabling only a single instance of that data. Some data may require decryption before it's accessible. Some tamper-proof systems may limit how many attempts you can actually make at decrypting it, et cetera, et cetera. There are many different types of data that will be, that can be found on a ship, and I'll detail but more of those in a few slides from now. The last and most visual method of salvage is hull scraping, which essentially entails using a salvage beam to vaporize the outer hull of a ship and collect that material in storage canisters. This is very similar to mining, except the materials extracted can occasionally be in purified form. And so I included a video, it's from a couple years ago, just to kind of illustrate the concept. And basically, this is just the damage texture, which is very, the same basic tech that we're going to use to extract it. So you could think of it as salvage for the hull scraping would be equivalent to this combined with the mining arm and tractor beam that you see in mining right now, to where you're literally just ripping the exterior hull, and therefore different ships will have different materials, and therefore different quantities of value that you can pull from this in this fashion. And the last thing I wanted to touch on today is actually discovery. And this is one of my favorite occupations and involves the acquisition of what I would call locational information. These packets of information can be procured via various methods. They can be actively sought out via scanning. A long-range scan from orbit might indicate that some valuable commodities are present in a given parcel of land, but with a good amount of uncertainty as to the quantity. Information can also be obtained by chance. You might simply be flying around in deep space and come upon a previously undiscovered asteroid field. Perhaps, that's what pulled you out of, your quantum travel. You can also engage in analysis, say, for example, by inspecting a parcel of land up close and personal so that you attain a level of certainty you wouldn't be able to achieve from a long-range scan. And so you can think of discovery, in some sense, as the grease that allows other occupations to function and or focus. Salvage ships need to know where there's something we're salvaging, and a lot of miners will want to focus on the actual process of extracting value rather than the process, the very different skill set that will be required in terms of finding those materials. There are a lot of different types of locational information, and some of those allow for successive deeper layers of discovery, sometimes increasing the value dramatically and other times rendering the find completely worthless. A chunk of metal determined to be a wrecked or derelict ship that was found via a long-range scan might have a very small amount of value, but not nearly as much as if you actually took the time and ventured closer and verified the type of the ship and its current state, whether it had already been stripped down, in which case it would have no value, or whether it was operational, in which case the value would be worth quite a bit more. Similarly, the discovery of a previously unknown asteroid field or a comet wouldn't be worth a lot, although verification that they contain valuable resources that are currently in high demand could make their value skyrocket. A planetary body or a moon has millions of parcels of land, and close inspection of a parcel enough to verify that something of value is present would also result in the creation of a bit of information. And lastly, a stable intrasystem wormhole that allowed a lot of travel time to be saved would often find a willing market. And there are other things, geysers, nebula, et cetera, that will be of various interest to scientists, tourists, tourist NPCs, things of that sort. And these packets of information that you collect are stored within a dedicated MobiGlass application and allow you to share that information with other players and organizations. And it's important to note that the value of information degrades over time. So if you were to find, say, a rich deposit of gold on the surface of a planet, and gold was currently had a very high market value, then that very recent information would have a lot of value. If on the other hand you sat on it for a week or 2 weeks, at that point it's not worth very much at all because you don't know whether or not that gold has since been extracted, whether it's actually still there. So you can periodically go back and refresh your knowledge, travel to the location to verify that no one actually found that remote location in the mountains where you'd found that gold, and thus your find is intact. At that point, it's now current information again, and its value would once again reflect that. So information can be sold to info brokers, which is one of the primary ways by which players that engage in discovery will actually make money. They'll buy and sell based upon the current market value, which will be, again, dictated by supply and demand. So if the price of aluminum is in the tank, you wouldn't be able to make much selling the location of a ship that had a lot of aluminum on its hull. And so information in this sense is very much a commodity, and its value is going to ebb and flow with, you know, with other things in the economy. And once an info broker has actually purchased this information, it's going to be freely available for other players and NPCs to bid on like they would with, you know, with any other asset. So that's basically it. I'm sorry it went a little bit long. Say again?
Still got 10 minutes, man.
Wow, I thought it went long. Well, what we could do is we could basically, so what we have right here is Jake Mealy and Rob Reininger, two of the Austin designers, as I mentioned earlier. Mealy is practically single-handedly responsible for all of the vast changes and the much more efficient, you know, algorithmic content that's being layered onto the pricing models that we're utilizing. And so these guys could answer any questions in any level of detail that you may have in that area. Yeah, that's called payback.
The ultimate parry.
So if we do have a few minutes, we could answer a few questions. If anybody's got anything. Sure.
Are you looking at online time or offline time? Can I be a bad guy, go to prison, log out, log in my alt until my prison guy serves time? Are you seeing, what's your vision of that?
I would lean towards thinking that it's probably just constant time. But you know, again, the prison itself is still in the relatively early stages. There will be a lot of iteration. Like I said, we'll like we do with a lot of things, we'll start out relatively relatively minimalistically, and then we'll gradually expand out. Some of the bigger questions that we're facing in terms of the prison stuff is how do we make it fun? Exactly what type of gameplay are you engaging there? Because it really is, it's a confined space. And we know that we want to have the potential to meet interesting characters. It'd be almost like if you go back, you know, a year and a half ago to where we had Area 18 and you were confined to that space. And so imagine that space, and you've got gangs in there, and you can actually, you know, associate yourself with one of them, and that relationship translates to, you know, when you actually get released to the outside. And there would, of course, be the potential to actually escape from prison. And so there's a lot of potential that would really just be doing the same stuff that we're doing in a lot of other places. I mean, you build up, you know, a personal reputation with other characters within the game already. This one is, again, it's something that we don't expect the average player to be getting locked away for long periods of time, because we don't expect the average player to be committing, you know, lots of crimes in secure zones. And sure.
That's for the NPC technology. Would that be helpful for, I guess, in two specific cases, being a bonded merchantman seller, that's it, going to a planet and wanting to sell your wares? Would NPCs become aware of your presence?
So you're talking about whether if you had like a price on your head and you're basically moving into.
If you're selling goods as a bounty merchantman owner, that if you land on a planet, would NPCs just start to hear that there's a merchantman?
That's basically exactly. It's like it's what you would wind up having is these probability volumes that I mentioned, you know, earlier. They effectively, you know, give us a mathematical description of what you would potentially see. And like I said, so we are actually, or we will be, you know, simulating these things, you know, in more precise detail, like these little point entities. But once we get over to the game side, what we don't want to wind up doing is having to compare, for example, the location of an individual ship with, you know, a million or 10 million different NPCs and trying to, like, you know, infer stuff there. And so the probability volumes are really a pre-processing step that's performed in real time that takes this background information and makes it easily digestible for the game, so that, for example, this has been happening, you know, for quite a while within the game already, to where every time you jump, what we're basically doing is casting your path through the universe and plotting your course through all these probability volumes and figuring out where you would actually, you know, run into a particular entity. And this is all dictated right now, like I said, specifically by the designers going in and hand setting this stuff. And so the next step is basically hooking that stuff up to the back-end economy so that we can start to feed real-time information to these volumes so that the quantity of pirates, it ebbs and flows based upon what's actually happening. Sure.
With regards to the salvage mechanic, you mentioned that you at some point in time, you would be able to get possibly components off some of these salvage ships. Do you foresee the ability to get military-grade, certain components of military-grade is the first question, and thereby being able to update your own ships by interchanging some of the salvage components? And then will there also be the opportunity, and you kind of touched on it, but will there be the opportunity to salvage nearly fully operational ships that are, you know,
The opposite of salvage, of course, is repair. And so it's very possible you disable another player. You take out their engines, you take out the crew. Well, now you need to repair the engines before you can go on your way. Or you find a derelict ship and you basically perform enough repairs. You repair its hull. You basically replace its batteries. You give it a new power module, et cetera. And now it actually becomes operational again. And one of the reasons, I should just point out, one of the reasons why component extraction is, so high on the list is because it allows us to let players extract a significant amount of value before we actually have to deal with the complicated issues. Like, imagine you have an Idris and you've got these big, enormous, batteries, and you want to actually extract that entire thing. Well, that just becomes, a user interface and logistical nightmare. Whereas components, these nice little, small, easily, carryable things, it's a very simple way for us to allow you to go onto a ship, bypass the security systems, cut off these things, and extract, maybe not all, but significant chunks of the value in this manner. Data is the same way. So you can have ships that basically have the location stored on them, just like I was mentioning on Discovery. You can have a ship that has within its database that you can extract, that you can salvage, the location of a comet. Now you go verify the comet and actually see what its current state is. The hull scraping is just another way to basically pull a good chunk of the value of its hull plating and stuff off. And so the reason why those three are at the top of the list is they're the most straightforward and quickest ones to implement. And we want to get the basics of some of these things running as quickly as possible so that we can start to iterate on them and basically broaden the number of things that players can do within the game.
With the Discovery location data, do those locations exist temporarily as long as the player has the data? Or are these locations that are permanently, like, new places to explore, discover, people to come back?
Yeah, they're actually dynamically created, but as long as you retain knowledge of them, they would basically continue to exist. In other words, I'm flying, from point A to point B, or I'm doing a scan, and I actually locate, a new asteroid field. That asteroid field wasn't necessarily, always there. It was created, randomly. But now that you know about it, and you can think about this logically as being, these things wouldn't be static in the real world, right? These things are moving. So once you find it, well, I know where it's at as long as I keep pretty close, tabs on it. But if I ever just forget about it entirely, there's asteroids coming and going through the solar system, moving around, all the time. It's like there's no certainty that you're ever really going to be able to find it. Plus, there's always the question mark of, did another NPC, or player find it that you don't know about? Basically, mine it into nothingness. And so there are a lot of reasons why this thing may eventually not be there. But as long as you retain knowledge, as long as you go back and periodically refresh it, then you can keep it, in perpetuity.
Thank you. Tony, Chris mentioned it a little bit in the opening statement about survival play. I know we've talked about this a lot over the years, but what's the current state of thought in that? Say you get shot down and no comm equipment on a moon or a planet,
Well, that actually plays right into that dynamic mission system and the probability volumes that I was mentioning before, to where, in essence, what you'd wind up doing, you get shot down over a moon, and what you do right now is you basically fire up your service beacon and you basically, set it to, 100 credits, and basically you ask somebody for help. The problem is that if you're off in some distant moon or whatever the case may be, there may not be a player around you, or maybe the players that are on the same server as you are too far away, or maybe they're engaged in their own missions. And so what we want to do, you know, is basically allow NPCs to start to participate. And so if you're on that moon and you need transport, and you basically, you know, throw that request for assistance out there and no players assist, what the dynamic mission system would then do is query all of the nearby, you know, probability volumes and determine whether or not any NPCs would actually be interested in helping you. And that would depend, you know, largely upon, again, what they're doing. It's like, you know, maybe your price is too low, so you're not interested in them. But if you get the price to the right point, you will eventually pull one of those guys in there. And this, again, is a capability we don't have right now, because there's no easy or effective way for the designers to tap into it. And that's why we've got a lot riding on this thing, and we're so anxious to basically get it in as quickly as possible.
Is the survival mechanic any deeper? Have we thought about that, you know, going into the fact that you don't have any water, food, you know, such and such, so and so?
Yeah. Well, we've got thirst and hunger is actually on, you know, one of the things on the list that we've got slated to deal with next year, and this would be the same thing for, you know, for all the NPCs, to where you'll actually start to get you'll need to basically, drink, you'll need to eat, you'll need to do all of that, or else you'll very gradually, because we don't want to make it too annoying, start to suffer, you know, various deleterious effects. Sitter.
Question about simulated NPCs. How many on your backend database, how many variables and arrays are you maintaining just to keep that dynamic information stored so that you can calculate those probability volumes?
At any given time, the spoof ones are actually going to be fairly minimal, because they're not really created except as necessary. In other words, most of the time, so the eventual idea is to be simulating, you know, 10 or 20 million of these, you know, of these so-called, you know, the simulated NPCs. But they're very, very lightweight, don't need to be updated. You know, if it's when you're talking about that simulation, you're not doing 60 times a second, you're not doing 2 times a second. You're updating these guys, once every 5 minutes or so. Because it's not as if the simulated NPCs change their occupation on a second by second basis or anything like that. And so what you wind up having is a big repository of these characters that periodically reevaluate and decide, do I want to keep working at this factory, or is there something more attractive? Well, if I leave the factory and I decide to become a miner, what am I actually doing? Oh, well, if he's doing a miner, then all of a sudden there's a demand for more fuel in that area. And if he's not working at the factory, that means all of a sudden that, you know, the rates for, you know, factory workers, you know, you've got one less, you know, NPC that will actually be available to supply that, which means the cost of things that depend upon labor, you know, in general would go up. I mean, one NPC would never really matter. But, you know, you get the point. I mentioned also earlier that these simulated NPCs would have a direct impact on the things like the number of NPCs, the occupations that you see within the game. And by this I mean, so if we're simulating, say, 100,000, you know, distinct NPCs, simulated NPCs on the back end, then this may translate into 100,000 divided by, you know, 1,000. So you wind up with, well, that's 100 NPCs, you know, that you'd actually see walking around. And there would be all of your normal, you know, your normal persistent characters, your bartenders, your shopkeepers, that are actually very specific characters that have, you know, particular lines of dialogue recorded for them. And then there's all of the, you know, the so-called background characters. There's the window shoppers and the tourists and the blue-collar workers and, you know, and all of those sorts of guys. The vagrants, you know, the criminal, you know, elements, etc., that we can basically, you know, create at will to basically, you know, fill up the populace. And the other interesting thing is we can kind of bend that however we see fit, so that if, for example, you've got a mining colony, and therefore there's a lot of blue-collar workers, and there's not much in the way of advanced, you know, production capabilities or anything like that. And all of a sudden, the asteroid field that's near that area winds up getting depleted. Then all of a sudden, there's very little ore being brought in and being utilized, et cetera. And so what you would logically expect is lower per capita income, less employment, more crime, and what you'd wind up seeing over time would therefore be more of these simulated NPCs shifting their occupation from employed blue-collar worker to, you know, criminal, you know, to criminal element, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All the way to the back.
have a question just in general about automated vehicles. You could apply the same AI logic to vehicles and ships, and rather than have a simulated human piloting the ship, you'd have an AI representing, an autonomous ship piloting the ship.
Yeah, that's an interesting one, and I actually cut it because I was trying to not get too crazy on the time, and they're already giving me the sign here. I had a whole section on multi-crew, which we now have. We've talked about multi-crew for a long time, and we've never gone into precise detail about exactly what that meant and how are you going to interface, with it. How are you going to hire guys? How are you going to dictate what they did, et cetera? We have enough clarity at this point to where we can talk, pretty precisely about that. But that's an hour long talk in and of itself. And what you mentioned there is one of the optimizations, just to end on, is if you have a crew and you think about, imagine you've got an Idris and it's got 100 characters on it. It's exceedingly inefficient if you've got engineers down in the, engineers that you've hired down in the engineering section and there's no other players down there to actually see them. You don't really want them to be pathfinding, animating, doing all of this very computationally expensive stuff. It's incredibly wasteful. And then you think about, you can have lots of players with lots of ships, with lots of extra crew. And so everywhere, we're always thinking about ways that we can give you the illusion that it's doing more than what it is, or where we're looking for ways to optimize so that we're getting all of the beneficial end effects, maybe in some cases even more, like I mentioned earlier, without with all of the rampant waste that would come from just blindly. Doing some of this stuff. Well, one of the things we've been looking at is basically a couple of different levels of basically tapping down on the NPC functionality so that you would still get all of the behavioral benefits of having an engineer down in the engineering section. He would still repair things at the rate of speed that he normally would. He could still be injured if there was damage done to that part of the ship, but we're able to basically turn off some of those high fidelity, animations, pathfinds, stuff like that, that are really only of benefit if a player's there. As long as they perform as they would if you were watching them, in another way, there's no reason to do all the extra work.